And, you know, the way this came about, really, Derek obviously has been filming his dad since you were a kid. And when Derek and I met at Sundance, and we both had expressed interest in the electrical grid.
We didn't want to watch movies and go skiing.
That's true.
So we,
maybe it was a
picture of this guy. Yeah, exactly.
When we started out to make this film on that first shoot in Texas, which is the first scene in the movie, I was the one who was sitting in the back with the camera getting tossed around by Dave's driving.
Aaron drove tonight.
And, yeah, he never drove again after that.
Yeah, no stereo tips.
I didn't even think of that story.
It all makes sense.
But it was the first time I realized that maybe what was going on between Derek and his dad was as interesting as anything else we would ever be filming. And I don't think anyone of us at that moment realized where that would lead. But
including me.
but I think one of the things that's really striking, and obviously we'd love to open up the conversation to all of you, but we live in this remarkably polarized time. This, you said you're thinking so such binary thoughts to Derek in that one scene in front of the Capitol. But we are living in a moment in which we have divided ourselves into these camps. And what I think is so remarkable when I see the way that you dealt with pressures on all sides on the electrical grid was the fact that you didn't allow yourself to be put in either one of those camps. The people who wanted renewables wanted all renewables, and the people who wanted fossil fuels are saying that climate change is a hoax. I've said this in interviews when we talked about the film, but I've never really asked you directly, so I'm going to ask you right now because I know you're okay with being put on the spot. Do you think that being transgender may allow you, knowing something of the male and the female, the yin and the yang, do you think that that may be why you were able to be so kind of measured or to see more sides of an issue that maybe we can't?
I don't really, of course, how would I know how to answer that question? Because I've only lived with myself my whole life. But I will say the one thing that I look at this all, I mean, every time I see this movie, it's hard. It really is hard for me to pull back because, you know, I'm 2 years into it now, and there's I feel so good, and it's easy to forget how painful things are. You know, we heal and we move on. So that said, I will say that so now I look at it as this incredible gift I've been given. And it's a gift of ability to see things that, I mean, I can talk all night, you know, if I'm not doing it for a Bureau of Labor, we can do that. But we're, you know, certainly one of the things I didn't recognize was, of course, the differences in how genders are treated, you know. So there's things that I'm seeing today, but the one gift, the biggest gift this has given me is to understand what it's like to be different and to be part of one of probably the most oppressed groups that exists. Now, of course, I'm still white, so it could be worse. but certainly, you know, looking at it out, I see this as a real gift, and it's the gift of understanding and love that I've been given. And so when I look at what people do, I know, and it's hard, it may be hard for you all to accept this, but I know people have good intent.
Thanks. Derek, I'm going to ask you one question too, not to put you on the spot, but when you see this film now, it's hard for me sometimes not to think of the roller coaster that we went through making it. And I'm not sure, I think tonight watching this again, I realize the amount that you put yourself out in this film, and you were never intending to be in front of the camera on this project. How does it strike you now, and do you feel like you have a little bit of space, like your dad does, from the high emotions that we all went through on this?
Yeah, definitely. I mean, while we were doing this film, if it wasn't for Mary, my wife and partner and everything, and my children, I think I would have spun out. I don't think I would have made it. Just because once, you know, when it was just Aaron and I and a couple other people, and really just me as a hobby, just filming, you know, the filming part's really easy. You just record all day, you know, yeah, this is gonna be the most amazing shot. You know, whatever it is that you're doing, it's easy. And then when you start going through it and putting it together and relating it, like the footage I found, the archival that my grandparents shot, my grandfather's, the one black and white shot where my dad, I think he's about 7 years old, and it's so haunting still to this day. It's like, oh my God, that's real. Like that, look at the way he, or you know, she's looking at the young girl. Like it was always
incredible.
Yeah, and so I mean, just, so when you're going through the footage, maybe that's why I always got into filming things, because I knew as humans we're incapable of remembering facts right after they happened. Like, you know, something happened 10 minutes ago, I'm immediately gonna bias it into somehow I wasn't at fault, right? That's the human nature. So maybe that's why I've always been into cameras, because you film it and then you look at it years later and you're like, oh, okay. Like it becomes very clear. Or, yeah, I was right, Twitter is horrible. I said that to my dad. I was like, wow, I thought Twitter was bad then. It's like, I wonder if I could see into the future how horrified I would have been. So it's very interesting now to see it, be separated from it, and be happy about what we did, but more so happy for the support that people like Aaron and Eugene and, you know, everybody involved in the film put, you know, for not just me, but the family, because they saw how important this story was and all the stuff that was already there. So having distance from it is really great. And it was almost the first screening I had that felt sort of like an out-of-body experience, where I felt like I was watching myself watch the movie, and I didn't think about the details. I didn't think about, oh, that audio was bad, you know, getting into details of it, so thank you.
This has been a very difficult film to sell, to be perfectly frank. It's been a really hard film to market and to get out into the world. There are numerous environmental film festivals that we've submitted this film to, and many of them have passed because they say that this is a family story, really, and it's a gender story, which doesn't have anything to do with the environment. And there are a number of LGBTQ festivals to which we've submitted the film, and they said, yeah, Christine's an interesting character, but there's all that stuff about, you know, climate and the environment.
True story. This is not a lie. Which is why we should be really thankful that ITVS took such a risk. Like, you know, during it, I may have been mad at them because, you know, they have rules and regulations. But now, being removed from it and seeing what's happened, they took a huge risk supporting this movie because, you know what? It doesn't confirm any biases at all. This is not Fox News. It's not MSNBC. You know, it's not Al Gore yelling at Donald Trump. It's the truth, and the truth is muddy, and it's not sellable. So, I mean, just him saying that, and you should laugh, because there's probably some emails even about being mad at ITVS, but like every person who's ever supported this, the film festivals who awarded us, that's, you know, they've put it out there and they're also trying to change the conversation.
I do think, though, that it's representative of that siloed thinking that's so representative of our time. Whether it's the internet or the media, the fact that we tend to ally ourselves with these groups that are oriented around a certain issue or things that we agree with, I see as being a very troubling thing. So even though this film, I think, admittedly, struggles to find its narrative, that's what I feel best about when I see it, is that it is a muddy story. It's a complicated story, and it's a story that doesn't have obvious heroes and villains. It's a story that posits that we are all in this together, and that family, whether it's our loved ones that we share a home with, or the human family that's grappling with a hurting home as well, those messy stories are the ones that we have to live and to resolve. Yeah, we'd love to take some questions.
Generate their own power and form their own microgrids. And the answer to that is you can do anything you want. You know, I would say, you know, part of my sensitivity is for the low-income folks. And if you look at rural America, you know, rural America is seeing the greatest amount of poverty. Step function in poverty in the last 5 years has been tremendous. So I'm gonna get to that answer. A community could make its microgrid. Have I seen communities that have chosen to go there yet? No, it's very expensive right now. But we will get there by 2020. That's our goal on our grid. I mean, there's a lot of good news following this year. I thought I would lose, you know, I'd lose my ability to have influence at the national level, but it's interesting, things have gone the other way. We're working on grants currently. By 2020, we will have a platform that will allow that. But the thing is, you've got to have the software platforms, the communication platforms, to talk to the group, to grid, to allow that to happen. Because, you know, the people want reliable power. As things get more complicated and become more dependent on our electricity, it has to be more reliable. So building on an isolated, reliable microgrid that provides you the same reliability. I should point out that when we tried to have this film last time, the power went out, so it's, you know, some places have more power than reliable power than others. But you know, so I think we're going to be there on our electric system at Vermont Electric Co-op by 2020. We will have all the platforms in place, everything to do that. We're running major storage studies and experiments. 2018, we've got utility scale storage going, commercial scale storage going, residential scale storage going. So we're not yet, but we'll be there.
Another question?
Yes, this is a question for Gary. How do your children relate to Christine?
yeah, so my children, Maggie, who was born... sorry, the question was, how do my children relate to Christine and how my mother is relating to Christine? And my children, Jack, they refer to her as Owa instead of Opa, because my mom is Oma, because she comes from German heritage, so it's very cute, and, you know, Owa is its own term that, I think, did you come up with that?
Yeah, I came up
with yeah, Owa,
when,
right?
When we were offered what we were going to be, I said, I'm not going to be Opa. So at the time I was still Dave, I said, I'll be Owa, because that means whatever right now. And in the future that can mean woman, so that works both ways.
So, you know, for Maggie never met Dave. She's only two, so she only knows Owa that way. I think Jack at this point, you know, I think it's been kind of, he was so young, I don't think he really remembers anymore either. Because they both say she, so, which is great. And, but, you know, mom's still struggling. It's very difficult. She's doing better and better, but, you know, like any major change that happens, you know, there's violent swings of a pendulum of emotions, you know. One day you're in great shape, the next day you're not. So, but, you know, there's still... So, you know, I did not think they'd be living together still. They're still living together and making it work as, you know, having separate lives but still be together.
So we're five-star roommates now.
Yes?
I have a question for Christine. The ending was very sort of poignant as you went bravely into the office as Christine. And there were references to the difficulty at work, but how now, 2 years into it, are there still awkward moments? Have you lost friendships, or do you feel that you are respected as a professional and it's becoming a non-issue?
Well, that's kind of what I was alluding to earlier. It really is uncanny that not only am I respected as a professional, I've now been elected to a lot of these national positions. In fact, I'm about to resume in 2018 the chair of the Business and Strategies Advisory Committee of the National Rural Enterprise Association, that serves 75% of landmass in the country. So I would have never predicted getting higher levels of respect as we move forward. As far as my interpersonal relationships with the employees at work and our board of directors, I don't detect any issues at all. Now, of course, the first month it was like walking on eggshells. And I say, you know, I personally faith, pray to God, I say, God, why couldn't I have been the CEO of like an artist community? Why'd have to be a utility? So it was really hard to face the line workers. So I think it was equally tough for both sides. But we came over it, you know, it was about a month, and then things returned back to normal, and I can absolutely say today that I feel well received. We're doing great. We're attracting excellent employees. We're getting the best, you know, I think our demographics have shifted about 10 years in the past, two or three, because all these young people are coming to the company. Brilliant. So we're able to do a lot, so it's very exciting from the profession standpoint.
Okay, that's all great what you just said, but you prefaced the whole statement that you've been making that you now feel like you are one of the most oppressed groups in the world. So what are you picking up about being a woman that made you say that?
Oh, thank you for that question.
Oh boy. But I think that's what you want, so here it comes.
It's almost a miracle of what's going on right now in our country. It's a revolution, and a very good revolution when it comes to women's rights. And I'm going to say the thing that I'm most impressed about in terms of my learning is, as a white male, I did not recognize gender bias in the workplace, and I now see so many examples. And day in and day out, men say things to women that I don't even think they're aware they're saying. And I'm going to give you one very powerful example. My little daughter, Kirsten, she's very brilliant. And we were having dinner every 2 weeks as we went through this. And after I transitioned, there was something that happened that was really just the beginning of the floodgates of things that I've observed. But I'll use this one example. I'm in a meeting with a bunch of male peers, that other CEOs. There's about 20 of them. And I met with this group on a regular basis, almost monthly, because it's a peer group. And I said something in the morning, this is when I began, about a week after I became Christine. I said something in the morning and nobody heard me. And then I repeated it later on. I said something else later and nobody heard me. Now that's never happened to me as a man. Now in the afternoon, one of the men said something and the other man said, oh yeah, Christine said that this morning. So that, a couple nights later, I'm having dinner with my daughter. She says, how's your transition going? I said, well, I think I'm experiencing transphobia. I told her the story. She says, no, welcome to being a woman. And I'll tell you one more story, too. This one never happened as a man. And I thank God I'm able to get my anger off, because when people said this in the beginning, I just wanted to punch them. So, strangers in the street would say to me, smile, sweetie. Like, what the hell is that? I feel like smiling. And why the hell would you ever say that to me? But it happens all the time. Smile, sweetie, is extreme. But men say to women, smile. What the hell do I have to smile for? It's not that you would never say that to another man. And I can give you a list of examples like that. And it's just, and I'm so happy women are rising up. The unfortunate thing is I don't know how men will get it, because I didn't get it. So, but I thank God for the learning.
That's a great question, and that's actually, I think, the reason Eugene was so interested in this, for his own perspective to see what would happen. It definitely sped mine up, which is why it was so tough, because I feel like it might have been a decade compressed into 6 months, really, when we were finally, when Anoush, the editor, was magically, as you asked, how did she put all this together? We had a wonderful person named Anoush, and she put it all together magically and made it feel like you're watching a scripted film rather than a documentary. And that process really did speed it up for me. So I appreciate that question. I guess I should repeat it. She was asking if the making the documentary sped it up for me experiencing that, and if for my dad having that pressure of us, me filming, sped it up for her.
One of the things, again, the relationship that my son and I have is so precious. I certainly feel like I grew through my son's questions. You can see that in the movie. His challenging our thoughts, you see him challenging with me, I don't understand how you can live these two lives. Saying to his mom, I don't understand, it was okay. So it's okay to get castrated for cancer, but so those are just great, and not so for being transgender. Those are such excellent deep questions that he asked that really helped me think. You know, I don't know what would have happened without the movie, but it certainly helped me move through the process.
Would you like some soy sauce? Was going to be the tagline.